Good morning everyone. I am Dr. Suvarnakar from Department of Ophthalmology. So today's topic for discussion is diseases of orbit. We will discuss this topic under the headings of anatomy of the orbit, proptosis, inflammations of the orbit, orbital cellulitis, cavernous sinus thrombosis, Graves ophthalmopathy, tumors of orbit, orbital blowout fractures. So coming to the anatomy of the orbit. The eyeballs lie in a quadrilateral pyramid-shaped bony cavity situated on either side of the root of the nose, called orbit. The orbital bones are developed from neural crest cells. The bones of orbit differentiate during third month of gestation and later undergo ossification. The orbit attains its adult size around 16th years of life. What is bony orbit? The bony orbits are situated between anterior cranial fossa above and maxillary sinuses below. Each orbit is approximately 40 millimeters in height, width and depth. Orbit is formed by 7 bones: frontal, maxilla, zygomatic, sphenoid, palatine and lacrimal. This is the figure showing different bones of the orbit. Now coming to the walls of the orbit. Medial walls are parallel to each other, formed by ethmoid, lacrimal, maxillary and sphenoid, lesser wing. Thinnest wall, so frequently fractured in injuries, orbitotomy surgeries and also paranasal sinus infection, ethmoiditis can cause orbital cellulitis easily. The lateral wall, formed by zygomatic and greater wing of the sphenoid, triangular in shape and covers the posterior half of the eyeball. The roof of the orbit, triangular in shape and formed by orbital plate of frontal bone and lesser wing of the sphenoid. The floor, formed by orbital plate of maxilla, the other bone is palatine and third one is zygoma. It is weak and involved in blowout fracture and easily invaded by tumors of maxillary sinus. The base of the orbit, it is anterior open end and covered by a thick orbital margin, and apex, it is the posterior end of the orbit having two orifices, optic canal and superior orbital fissure. The superior orbital fissure and optic canal, they covered by a tendinous ring called as annulus of Jean, and this gives origin to extraocular muscles. This is the figure showing the orbital walls. If you see, these two are medial walls, they are parallel to each other, while these are lateral walls, they are making an angle of 90 degrees. Now coming to apertures of the orbit, superior orbital fissure located in between greater and lesser wing of the sphenoid, and the structures passing through the superior orbital fissure or third nerve, fourth nerve, ophthalmic division of the fifth and sixth cranial nerves, along with sympathetic fibers from cavernous plexus. The superior ophthalmic vein also passes to cavernous sinus. Inferior orbital fissure between lateral wall of the orbit and floor of the orbit. It transmits infraorbital nerve, zygomatic nerve, branch from the pterygopalatine ganglion and pterygoid venous plexus. Optic canal, it is around 10 millimeter in size and present in lesser wing of the sphenoid. The optic nerve, ophthalmic artery, sympathetic nerves pass through the canal, and it is part of the tendinous ring as we have seen previously. Volume of the orbit is 30 ml approximately, and the eyeballs, they make the 1/5 volume. And the other structures are nerves, extraocular muscles, lacrimal gland, lacrimal sac, ciliary ganglion, ophthalmic artery and vein, orbital fat and fascia. This is the figure showing superior orbital fissure, inferior orbital fissure, optic canal and the tendinous ring with four recti muscles and the structures passing through the various apertures. Coming to the surgical spaces, there are four spaces. The subperiosteal space, this is a space between bones and periosteum. Second is the peripheral space, it is bounded peripherally by periorbita and internally by extraocular muscles and intermuscular septa. The central space, also called retrobulbar or muscular cone, bounded anteriorly by Tenon's capsule lining back of the eye, and peripherally four recti muscles, posteriorly continuous with the peripheral space. And last space is Tenon space. It is a potential space around eyeball between sclera and Tenon's capsule. Again, this is a figure showing various spaces. Number one is periorbital space, second is peripheral space, third one is muscular cone or retrobulbar space, and fourth was is subtenons or Tenon's space. The structures, which are commonly structures, means some tumors which develop in different spaces, those are given here. Extraconal lesions, those are dermoid cysts, lacrimal gland tumors, rhabdomyosarcoma, extension of the nasal or sinus disease. Intraconal lesions are cavernous hemangioma, optic nerve glioma or meningioma, and AV malformations. Muscular disorders are thyroid ophthalmopathy, pseudotumor, cysticercosis, lymphoproliferative disorders. Coming to the blood supply of the orbit, external carotid artery supplies to the lids and periorbita and face, while eyeball and orbit is supplied by mainly by ophthalmic artery, which is a branch of internal carotid artery. A branch of middle meningeal artery also supplies to the orbit. Orbit is drained by superior and inferior ophthalmic veins into the cavernous sinus. There are no lymphatics in the orbit. This is the figure showing blood supply of the orbit. Now coming to the topic of proptosis. Proptosis, in short, it is a protrusion of the eyeball in front of the orbital margins. Forward displacement of the eyeball beyond the orbital upper and lower margins. It is also called as exophthalmos, but exophthalmos is specially attributed to the condition in thyroid ophthalmopathy, thyroid eye disease. Proptosis can be axial or eccentric. The classification of the proptosis is unilateral proptosis, can be bilateral proptosis, can be acute proptosis, intermittent proptosis, and pulsating proptosis. Now we will see the causes of unilateral, bilateral, one by one. Causes of unilateral proptosis, there are congenital causes, dermoid cyst, congenital cystic eyeball, and orbital teratoma. The traumatic lesion, orbital hemorrhage, retained intraocular foreign body, traumatic aneurysm, emphysema. The inflammatory lesions are orbital cellulitis, orbital abscess, thromboflebitis, panophthalmitis, cavernous sinus thrombosis. Chronic lesions, just like pseudotumor, tuberculoma, gamma, and sarcoidosis. The fourth cause is circulatory and vascular lesions, angioneuritic edema, orbital varices and aneurysms. Cysts of the orbit, implantation cysts, parasitic cysts. Tumors of the orbit, as we know, tumors of the orbit can be congenital, can be benign, can be malignant, and they arise from the orbital tissue. Mucocils of the paranasal sinuses. If you see in pediatric age group, the commonly conditions where you see proptosis, unioocular proptosis particularly, is trauma, dermoid cyst, hemangioma, optic nerve glioma, rhabdomyosarcoma, and leukemia. In adult, orbital cavernous hemangioma, meningioma, mucocils of paranasal sinuses, and secondaries from breast, lungs, and gastrointestinal tract is common. This is a picture showing unilateral, axial, as well as downward proptosis. Maybe secondaries or maybe meningioma. Now coming to causes of bilateral proptosis, the main cause in pediatric A group and very common is developmental anomalies, craniosynostosis. Craniosynostosis means it is a premature fusion of the sutures, coronal sutures, giving a different shape to the orbits and face. The oxycephaly, where coronal suture is fused and the skull takes a shape of tower, the tower shape, deformity. Brachycephaly, all cranial sutures are fused earlier. Scopocephaly, sagittal suture is fused earlier, giving the boat shape. Then the trigonocephaly, it is where frontal suture is fused. Second one is craniofacial dysostosis. In craniofacial dysostosis, you can see Crouzen syndrome, Apert syndrome. It is premature closure of all sutures associated with maxillary hyperplasia. What are ocular features? Those are bilateral proptosis, divergent squint, hypertelorism, optic atrophy. Systemically, you will see mental retardation, high arch palate, irregular dentition, and hooked nose or parrot beak. Second condition is mandibulofacial dysostosis or Treacher-Collins syndrome. It is because of the hypoplasia of the zygoma and mandible. Ocular findings are indistinct inferior orbital margin, coloboma of the lower lid, and anti-mongoloid slant. Systemically, macrostomia with high arch palate, external ear deformity, and bird-like face. Coming to the other causes, there may be osteopathies, osteitis deformans, rickets, and acromegaly. Inflammatory conditions are cavernous sinus thrombosis, Mikulicz syndrome. In cavernous sinus thrombosis, initially unilateral proptosis is there, but later on it extends to both eye, both orbit. So thyroid ophthalmopathy, maybe thyrotoxic or maybe thyrotropic, you will have bilateral proptosis. Tumors, bilateral lymphoma or lymphosarcoma. Secondaries from neuroblastomas, nephroblastoma, leukemia, leukemic infiltration. Systemic diseases are histiocytosis, xanthomatosis, Wegener's granulomatosis. Causes of acute proptosis. Fracture of the medial orbital wall because of the injuries, road traffic accident, causing orbital emphysema, orbital hemorrhage, and rupture of the ethmoidal mucosa. Intermittent proptosis, it is because of the vascular lesions, especially orbital varices, periodic orbital edema, recurrent orbital hemorrhage, and vascular tumor. Causes of the pulsating proptosis, carotico-cavernous fistula, secular aneurysm of the ophthalmic artery, cerebral pulsations felt due to deficient orbital root, congenital meningocele. Proptosis in children, we already seen. The common causes are dermoid and epidermoidosis, capillary hemangioma, optic nerve glioma, rhabdomyosarcoma, leukemias, flexiform neurofibromatosis, and lymphomas. This is a picture of unilateral proptosis. Coming to the clinical evaluation of the proptosis, the history is very important. In history, you must ask about the age of the onset, nature of the onset, if any history of orbital or head injury, duration of the proptosis, progression, chronology of the orbital signs and symptoms. In local examination of the proptosis, inspection is very important, whether proptosis is axial or eccentric, what is the condition of the lid, whether it is retracted, how is the skin, whether if you feel, if you palpate with the finger, how is the temperature. All the things you must see in inspection. In palpation, you should palpate by fingers around eyeball it may show presence of the tumor mass. If supranasal tumor mass is there, it may be mucosal, it may be neurofibromata. If superotemporal mass is there, it may be a dermoid, it may be a lacrimal gland tumor. Coming to the auscultation, many in many cases you can listen to the BRUI in AV communication specially, so you have to auscultate. Transillumination, if the tumor mass is in the anterior portion, you can transilluminate that. Visual acuity may be diminished, pupil reaction may be normal, dilated, sluggishly reacting, or totally dilated and not reacting. Then ocular motility may be reduced. Ocular motility is reduced especially towards the side of the lesion. If it is, the lesion is nasally, medial movement of the eyeball, it will be restricted and accordingly. Actual measurement of the bulging, it is done by exophthalmometry. Actual how much eyeball is protruded, you can measure with the instrument exophthalmometer. And before measuring, you can see in doubtful cases whether only eyeballs are prominent, whether proptosis is there or not, you can confirm by putting a scale vertically over the orbital margins. If the scale touches to the orbital margins, upper and lower and center of the cornea, actually there is no proptosis. But if it is not there, then definitely proptosis is there, and you can measure with exophthalmometer. Available routinely used exophthalmometers are either Luddy's and Hertel's. Luddy's exophthalmometer, it is a simple scale, transparent scale, calibrated on both sides. And this measures the distance between orbital lateral angle of the bony orbit and the central of the cornea when patient is looking straight forward. The normal distance may be 10 to 20 millimeters. In different books, different measurements have been given. The normal distance accepted is 16 millimeter, and if it exceeds 20 millimeter or difference of 2 millimeter between two eyes, it is definitely significant. In whites, below 20 millimeter is normal value, and in blacks, below 22 millimeter. This is the figure showing Luddy's exophthalmometer and Hertel's exophthalmometer. What are clinical signs and symptoms? Redness, watering, forward bulging of the eyeball, maybe eccentric also. Eyeball protrusion beyond the lid margins, maybe unioccular or bilateral. Eyeball protruding forward or eccentric. Acuity of the vision may be diminished. Impaired motility. Diplopia may be seen. Conjunctiva congested. Cornea may show signs of exposure keratitis. Pupils normal or RAPD will be there. IOP may be raised in TED, thyroid eye disease. And on fundus examination, you may see papilledema and optic atrophy. What are the lab investigations? Routine hemogram. If it is an inflammatory lesion, you may see the leukocytosis, lymphocytosis, polymorphonuclear. Then complete blood count for that, urine routine, and Bence-Jones proteins for multiple myeloma. Stool examination is important to see the ova and cyst, parasitic infestation especially. Many times it gives a tumor mass or cyst, which are responsible for proptosis of the eyeball. Thyroid function tests are important, serum T3, T4, and TSH estimation for thyroid disease. Cassoni's test to rule out the hydatid cyst. It is important. And lastly is FNAB, fine needle aspiration biopsy culture and sensitivity. Coming to the imaging technique. Imaging technique can be non-invasive technique. Previously only plain X-ray was available. So PA view or lateral view to see the orbital margins and details. Caldwell view or Waters view to see paranasal sinuses. X-ray shows enlargement of the orbital cavity or enlargement of the optic foramina, calcification or hyperostosis. The CT scan orbit, it is very helpful in location and size of the tumor. CT scan is useful in visualizing various structures, globe, extraocular muscles, globe and surrounding structures, cranial cavity, paranasal sinuses and nasal cavity. Disadvantage is that it cannot differentiate the tumor masses pathologically and shows radiological isodense. Magnetic resonance imaging, it is useful in detection of the normal and abnormal soft tissues. It has got excellent tissue resolution. Ultrasonography, it is non-radiational, non-invasive, completely safe and valuable in primary scanning of the orbital tissue. It is useful in finding out cystic, solid, infiltrative and spongy masses. Invasive procedures are orbital venography, carotid angiography, radioisotope studies. Now these are highly high-tech investigation, rarely done, especially in vascular tumors if you are suspecting. And lastly is histopathological examination, fine needle aspiration biopsy, incisional biopsy if the tumor mass is smaller one, bigger one, just take part of the tumor mass and send for histopath. And if the tumor mass is small one, if it can be removable totally, the total removal of the tumor and sending it for HP, that is excisional biopsy. And coming to the treatment of proptosis, actually treatment of a case of proptosis, it varies by etiology. You cannot give the exact treatment for proptosis in general, but in general some measures you can do whenever there is exposure of the cornea. Lubrication to protect the cornea is required in severe cases when cornea is exposed. Surgery to provide better coverage of the eye surface. Again, same thing, either lead surgery or tumors may be, must be surgically removed. Selective embolization or rarely trapping procedures may be effective in cases of arteriovenous fistulas involving the cavernous sinus. Graves of exophthalmos is not affected by treatment of the thyroid condition. It is a condition and it has got remissions and exacerbations. Generally, you may see remission in 1 to 3 years with the level of the T3, T4 and TSH control. These are various lesions shown in the figure. Coming to the enophthalmos, which is exactly opposite to proptosis, it is the inward displacement of the eyeball. Enophthalmos can be unilateral or bilateral. It must be differentiated from microphthalmos and thyroid bulbi. What are the causes of enophthalmos? Congenital, microphthalmos and maxillary hypoplasia. Traumatic, blood fractures of the floor of the orbit. Post-inflammatory, cicatrization of the extraocular muscles. Neurogenic causes, Horner syndrome, paralysis of the superior and inferior oblique muscles. Atrophy of the orbital tissue, insanity, dehydration, periocular repeated injections of the steroid and following irradiation of the orbit. Now coming to the orbital inflammations. Orbital inflammations can be acute orbital inflammations, chronic orbital inflammations. In acute orbital inflammations, the common condition is preseptal cellulitis, orbital cellulitis and orbital abscess, orbital osteopathies, orbital thrombophlebitis, tenonitis, cavernous sinus thrombosis. And in chronic orbital inflammations, specific inflammations, especially tuberculosis, syphilis, actinomycosis, mycotic infections, mucormycosis, and parasitic infestations. Chronic non-specific inflammations are inflammatory pseudotumor, Tolosa-Hunt syndrome, or chronic orbital periostitis. The preseptal cellulitis, infection of the subcutaneous tissue anterior to orbital septum. The infection is confined to leads and periorbital tissue. Causative organisms are Staphylococcus aureus and Staphylococcus pyogenes. Infection can spread from local infections, from exogenous source or endogenous infection. Clinically present as edema of the leads, periorbital skin, but no involvement of the orbital tissue. No proptosis and ocular movements are not restricted. Associated fever and leukocytosis. Diagnosis can be confirmed by CT scan. The treatment of preseptal cellulitis is oral or IV antibiotic and anti-inflammatory drug. A localized abscess, if it is there, surgical drainage. This is a picture showing preseptal orbital cellulitis, where you can see the lead edema, reddening of the skin. Coming to the orbital cellulitis, etiology, again, causative organisms are Staphylococcus aureus, Staphylococcus pyogenes, Haemophilus influenzae, Aspergillus, mucormycosis. Infection can be exogenous infection, can be penetrating injury with retention of the intraocular foreign body, extension from intracranial infections, extension from paranasal sinuses, or teeth, face, leads or intraorbital tissue. Endogenous infection, many times it is metastatic infection from breast abscess, peripheral abscess, thrombophlebitis of legs, and septicemia. Orbital cellulitis is the most common cause of proptosis in the early childhood. What are clinical features of orbital cellulitis? Symptoms will be swelling and pain, which is increased on movement of the eye or pressure. Associated symptoms may be fever, nausea, vomiting, prostration, and sometimes loss of vision, diplopia. Signs of orbital cellulitis cases, you will see marked swelling of the lids, swelling hard with redness of the skin, a marked phimosis of the conjunctiva, and necrosis may be there. Axial proptosis of the eyeball, mild to severe restrictions of the ocular movements, abnormal pupillary reaction may show apical involvement. Fundus shows congested retinal veins with papilledema or papillitis. CT scan examination is important in the diagnosis. The picture showing orbital cellulitis, you can mark here the mark orbital lead edema, conjunctival edema. Complications. Ocular complications are exposure keratopathy, optic neuritis, central retinal artery occlusion. Orbital complications are subperiosteal abscess, orbital abscess, temporal parotid abscess due to spread of the infection. Intracranial complications may be there, like cavernous sinus thrombosis, meningitis, or brain abscess. And general septicemia may be there if condition not treated. Investigations, hemogram, bacterial culture, orbital ultrasonography to see the intraocular extension, CT scan in MRI help to see the intracranial extension. Here we can see the differential diagnosis of acute inflammatory proptosis in following conditions: cavernous sinus thrombosis, orbital cellulitis, and panophthalmitis. If you see clinical features, laterality, cavernous sinus thrombosis generally initially unilateral, but soon it becomes bilateral. In orbital cellulitis, it is always unilateral. In panophthalmitis also, it is always unilateral. Degree of proptosis, it is moderate in cavernous sinus thrombosis. Orbital cellulitis, it is marked, and in panophthalmitis, it is again moderate. Vision, not affected in early stages in cavernous sinus thrombosis. while it is not affected in early stages in orbital cellulitis also, and complete loss of vision from beginning in panophthalmitis. Cornea and entry chamber clear in early stages in cavernous sinus thrombosis, clear in early stages in orbital cellulitis also, while hazy due to corneal edema was in the entry chamber in panophthalmitis. Ocular movements, complete limitation to the palsy, marked limitation in orbital cellulitis, and painful and limited in panophthalmitis. Edema of the mastoid region present in cavernous sinus thrombosis. This is very important sign. Edema of the mastoid region, which shows the cavernous sinus thrombosis. It confirms the diagnosis of cavernous sinus thrombosis. Where in orbital cellulitis you will not see in the edema in mastoid region, and it is absent in panophthalmitis also. General symptoms with fever and prostration. Mark in cavernous sinus thrombosis, mild in orbital cellulitis and panophthalmitis. Coming to the treatment of orbital cellulitis, antibiotic is the main stay of the treatment. You have to give broad spectrum antibiotics, especially IV antibiotics you should give. And before starting the antibiotics, if possible, culture and sensitivity of the pus or blood, if possible, it is done. Loading doses of the broad spectrum antibiotics preferred, later on antibiotic change according to the culture report. Antibiotic treatment should be continued till 10 to 14 days. The second line of treatment is analgesics and anti-inflammatory drugs. Hot compresses locally. If condition doesn't resolve, line CT scan shows opacified sinuses and fluid, collection of the fluid, it should be drained. And if abscess has formed, incision and drainage is done. This is again a comparison between orbital inflammations various, lymphoproliferative disease, metastatic disease, non-specific orbital inflammations, orbital cellulitis, sarcoidosis, thyroid disease, Wegener's granulomatis. So, coming to the cavernous sinus thrombosis, due to extension of the thrombosis from various feeding vessels, superior and inferior ophthalmic veins enter in front, superior or inferior petrosal sinuses leave from behind, cavernous sinus communications with facial veins, lateral sinus, jugular vein, mastoid emissary vein, lateral sinus, superior petrosal sinus. So cavernous sinus on one side communicates with other side through transverse sinus. Because of the connection with mastoid through mastoid emissary veins, mastoid tenderness is diagnostic sign of the cavernous sinus thrombosis. Source of the infection, orbital veins, as in case of erysipelas, septic lesions of the face, orbital cellulitis, infective condition of the face, mouth, nose and sinuses. Furuncle of upper lip, it is a dangerous area of the face, a metastatic infection or septic condition. Symptoms and signs will be, it starts initially as unilateral condition but becomes bilateral, seriously ill, having high grade fever with rigors, vomiting and frustration. Patient may present with signs, symptoms of orbital cellulitis, severe supraorbital pain, conjunctiva is congested, proptosis develops rapidly, palsy of the third, fourth and sixth nerve occurs frequently, edema in mastoid region is diagnostic. Diagnosis is with CT scan and MRI, with contrast is useful. The treatment of the cavernous sinus thrombosis, condition is preventable with prophylactic chemotherapy, avoidance of squeezing of the boils over face and nose. Massive doses of the broad spectrum antibiotic by IV route for 3 to 4 weeks together with anticoagulant may control the infection. Systemic corticosteroids to reduce inflammation. Analgesics and inflammatory, anti-inflammatory drugs, they help in reducing edema and pain. Thank you.
तो कौन सा बटन दबाया जाता है?